Where do you put the Presidential Medal of Freedom among the honors that have come to David McCullough?
I consider it the highest honor I've received.
Yeah.
If I had to tally up what maybe matters most to me, is that none of my books has ever been out of print.
Wow.
In 50 years.
People are still reading them, every one of them.
Yes.
Yeah. It's great to have you here.
Thank you, Charlie. And
to be reminded.
I consider it a privilege to be your guest. You're tops.
Thank you. The book is called The American Spirit, Who We Are and What We Stand For. And it is a collection of speeches. And to know David McCullough is to know that when he writes a speech, he thinks about it because he has something he wants to say.
I grew up in Pittsburgh, Pennsylvania, which had a great influence on me. And
how so?
Well, for one thing, it was a city full of history, and there was a lot of history talked about. And it was during the Second World War when I was in grade school, and we were very much involved in spirit and attitude in the reality of the war, and that we in Pittsburgh were helping to win the war. We were the arsenal democracy and so forth and so on. And the conversations at the dinner table were about so much that it happened in Pittsburgh, the fires and the floods and the strikes and all, and the Johnstown flood and things like that, and the history of our own family. I think that what your parents and grandparents talk about has great influence on one's interest in history.
I've been very lucky in my subjects, Charlie, and the more you learn, the more you want to learn. And every book, I have never known a great deal about any subject that I've embarked upon to write about, ever.
So there's a voyage of discovery for you.
Yes, and if I knew all about it, I wouldn't want to write the book. It's a journey, and you learn so much by doing this, and you learn a lot about yourself.
Like what?
Well, this may sound strange, but I think writing history requires a great deal of imagination. I don't mean that you're making things up, but you have to be able to transport yourself into that other time and into the shoes of those other people, get inside their skins, if you will. Mm-hmm. And that takes imagination. That takes empathy and sympathy. I don't mean sympathetic in the sense of feeling sorry for them, but sympathetic in that you understand what trouble they were in or how complicated mm-hmm. the situation may have been and what they didn't know. We have to always remember they don't know an awful lot because they're caught up in the moment just as we are, and they don't know how things are going to turn out.
That's a very, go ahead.
But I also feel that for me it's been a opportunity for self-expression because I can express things that I feel about human nature, about life, about the bonds of friendship, family, about loyalty, about bravery under difficult circumstances, and about our country that I'm dying to express, that I want to express. I can't understand how anyone who professes to love our country can have no interest
in
our history.
Exactly.
And no question about it. Of all the years, 40 years I've been at work, the happiest, most fulfilling years. And I've loved every subject that I have undertaken. I've been very lucky in my subject. But the years I enjoyed most were the years writing the John Adams book because of that material. It was such a privilege to keep company with those people. They set such a high standard for us.
You believe that if your subjects live to an older age, they lose some of their inhibition. They have a different perspective on things. They're freer to talk with more
I think so.
Perspective.
I feel that way.
Yeah.
Somebody said, I don't know, maybe you know, that courage is having been courage is having done it before.
Yeah.
And I feel now that I see a lot more clearly than I did before. To write well is to think clearly. And that's why it's so hard. But it's also why it's so enjoyable. Writing is hard work, but I never equated ease with happiness. I'm often happier when I'm working than I am doing anything else. I'm on vacation every day.
That's because you found something you love.
I love it. And I want you to know what I love.
Yeah, me too.
I do. And I want you to know much more about our country. And I want people to understand that we too are being judged by history. History isn't just something that happened before we came on the scene. We're part of history. And how are we going to measure up? How will our political discourse, our participation as citizens, how will we look when they take a look at us 50 or 100 years from now?
You've been part of our history, and I thank you for sharing it with me.
Thank you, Charlie, very much, as always.
I have spent a lot of time with John Adams and Harry Truman and Theodore Roosevelt.
Right.
And I feel often, and lots of other biographers and historians have expressed the same thought, that you get to know these people in many ways better than you know people in real life. Because for one
thing— read their letters.
Exactly. And the letters are so revealing, and they're so often touching and eloquent. And the relationship between Bess and Harry Truman that's found in those letters, the relationship between Abigail and John Adams that's found in those letters. And there are over 1,000 letters between Abigail Adams and John Adams. And neither of them was capable of writing a boring letter or a short one. And you're reminded that history is human. History is not about memorizing dates and statistics and quotations. It's about human beings. And that's why it's so important. Jefferson said, any nation that expects to be ignorant and free expects what never was and never can be. And of course, he said, when in the course of human events, and the operative word there is human, none of these people who've occupied our highest office has ever been perfect. I like to write about people that I feel deserve more attention and credit. I like to bring them front and center stage. I like to write about the wives of these people. I like to write about people you've never heard of. Because why should they remain in the shadows or in the wings, as it were?
Yeah.
And the other, I'm drawn to people who set out to accomplish something worthy, noble even, that they knew would be difficult, and which turned out to be even more difficult than anyone imagined.
Yeah. Mm-hmm.
And they succeeded. I don't think that politics and the military should be seen as the whole of history.
No, okay, that's my point. I mean, because
much of what history is really made up of includes neither.
Yeah.
It can be the art, it can be the poetry, it can be the music that's going to last the longest by far. And we have to include that because that's part of being human. Truman said you have to wait 50 years for the dust to settle.
Right.
And that was very wise. And so I think these presidents would look different after a while. Historians ought to wait. Now, of course, this is my own personal feeling.
Yeah.
And some marvelous books have been written, as you know, about leading political figures within the 50-year
right
lineup. But if you're working in this field, there's always something new to discover. I have never embarked on a project wherein I didn't find something that nobody knew about. That's the wonder of it. That's the excitement of it.
You always find something nobody
always
knew about.
And sometimes it can be pretty big and exciting. And that's why I think how we teach history ought to be more in the spirit of the lab technique, that you don't just tell the student all about what happened and who did it and why and what it costs and so forth.
Right.
You give them a project to work on where they are doing the digging. They are figuring out the story. This was a commencement speech, and whenever I've been asked to deliver a commencement speech, I felt obliged honor bound to really make an effort to say something of consequence, right, and to prepare, work hard at preparing it. And I like to leave them with some convictions of mine that I really feel strongly about. I say, when bad news is riding high and despair in fashion, when loudmouths and corruption seem to own center stage, when some keep crying that the country is going to the dogs, remember it's always been going to the dogs in the eyes of some, and that 90% or more of the people are good people, generous-hearted, law-abiding, meanwhile, good citizens who get to work on time, do a good job, love their country, pay their taxes, care about their neighbors, care about their children's education, and believe rightly, as you do, in the ideals upon which our life is founded. Then I said, see the world. Take up painting or the piano. Mm-hmm. Discover how much you never knew about insects. Go climb a mountain. And whenever you check out of a hotel or motel, be sure you tip the maid.
Well said. You have said that history fosters optimism in
yes.
comparison to the hubris yes. of the present.
Yes. I feel that way.
Tell me what you mean.
Well, first of all, it shows that there was no simpler time ever. Yeah. And anybody that thinks that doesn't understand. The times past were very difficult, very heartbreaking, destructive, suffering in the extreme, terrific mistakes made that caused the anguish of thousands, millions of people. But we came out of those dark times, we human beings. We do figure out what went wrong and how to fix it. And we do make extraordinary improvements in the quality of life.
You call what you do a calling.
Yes, I do.
How is it a calling for you? Because it's simply, you tell me.
I want to bring to life the best that can be found in the story of why we are the way we are and how we got to where we are. That doesn't mean it's all good news, all wonderful, admirable people, not by any means. I think that what really happened is not only as interesting as stories that are concocted, but often more interesting. Yeah. And I've always thought of myself as a writer.
Not a historian.
Not an historian. But I'm writing about what really happened, yeah. and I'm not going to make anything up. I'm not going to change any facts and figures.
What's the gift, though? Beyond, you have the calling, but what's the gift? Is it?
Telling a story.
Telling storytelling.
As Barbara Tuchman said, there's no trick to writing history. Tell stories. That's what it is. And great stories.
And stories about real things and real people.
Yes. I think one of the important points is that we shouldn't just think of history as politics and the military, which is a huge part of it. But it isn't everything. That's why I've done what I've done with this book and others that I've written. They're not about politics in the military. Yes, politics in the military enter into it, but they're not about that. And I think that the future historians looking back on our time are going to be talking about other things than politics and military that we've achieved in our time, or mistakes that we made other than politics and the military.
You have said before that all of your books are about one of the first books that you read, The Little Engine That Could.
Yes, that's right.
That's the common denominator.
Yeah, I think I can, I think I can, I think I can.
I think I can.
Yeah. Again, that, as I was saying, it's how we're brought up. Yeah. That's the kind of book that I was raised on.
I love this. Wilbur Wright said, no bird soars in a calm.
Yes.
So fundamental and so true.
Yes. Adversity helps. Yeah. The old Irish saying, may the wind always be at your back.
Oh, I love that.
They just take that the reverse. You need the wind. You need them to give you the lift.
There's also this. This is an honorary degree you got from Yale, and you awarded this citation. As an historian, he paints with words. paints with words, giving us pictures of the American people that live, breathe, and above all, confront the fundamental issues of courage, achievement, and moral character. It's great to see you.
Charlie, it's always a treat to be your guest.
Oh, thank you.
Thank you.
How is your wife?
She is perfect. She's my editor-in-chief. She's my guiding star. Oh. She's the mission control for our family. Yes. Chair of the ethics committee.
There you go. Tell her I said.
I sure will.
Send her my best.
No, she's marvelous. Thank you.